Mass, will you remain 2 metres from anybody that isn't in your bubble? Keep your mask covering your nose and your mouth until we get to communion, when obviously we will change that, more of that later. And just be aware of people around you when you're moving around the church. We are still encouraged not to bounce up and down quite so much, so if you would kindly remain seated until the Gospel, then we can stand for the Gospel. I think that's everything I need to say on COVID. It's a bright sunny morning. Today we celebrate the Feast of the Holy and Undivided Trinity. So hopefully God will fill your hearts and your mind with the Son of his love. We will now have our choir singing the first hymn. Christ, God said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. God the Father forgives us in Christ and heals us by the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore put away all anger and bitterness, all slander and malice, and confess our sins to God our Redeemer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two, they covered their faces, and with two, they covered their feet, and with two, they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." This is the word of the Lord.
We know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him.
This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to tell you a tale. It's a true tale. On Trinity Sunday, 4 years ago, I was licensed as the interim priest in charge of a small church in South London. This was a church that had seen a decline in congregation and in work and in outreach and in everything, sadly, over a period of 25 years or so, to the point that the future of the parish itself was in question. Before I was licensed, the Archdeacon met with me to give me some background and some things to be aware of. There was one particular thing that he said to me that stuck out in my mind. He said that over his time looking after the congregation, he didn't really believe that they believed in the Holy Spirit, and they didn't seem to believe that God loved them. To me, this seemed quite a strange thing for him to say to me, but archdeacons are archdeacons, and I do not proclaim to understand their minds or their thoughts. But I think he was being nice. As I say, my licensing was on Trinity Sunday, quite an appropriate feast day, given the fact that my new congregation didn't seem to believe in the Holy Spirit. As with most of these things, the day itself was wonderful. Some people came from my previous parish, where I had been curate and associate priest, to support me and to cheer me on. The following Sunday, I arrived for Mass, and everything was quite flat. The building was empty when I arrived. I opened up, and knowing that the sacristan was away, began to get the building ready for worship. Somebody came through the front door of the church, which I had opened, and they quickly said to me, "No, no, I'm not staying. I just popped in because I thought the building had been closed for years. I've never seen the doors open." Apparently, the previous incumbent didn't like opening the doors to the church too early, and when he did, opened the side door so that from the front the church looked closed. As more people arrived for worship, I noticed that they didn't really talk to each other or to me before Mass. And that was absolutely fine. I'm a great fan in that saying, and the notice you see on churches that says talk to God before Mass and each other after. But what I did notice was they didn't seem to talk to God during the Mass either. They weren't really singing. They weren't really taking part in the words. It was almost as if they had come in body, but had left their mind at home for a rest. After this service, I was quite deflated and began to reflect again on what the Archdeacon had told me, that the congregation didn't seem to believe in the Holy Spirit and didn't seem to believe that God loved them. Over time, as I got to know and talk to people, I began to realise that coming to church and worshipping God for them didn't change their lives at all, either as individuals or as a worshipping community. They didn't seem to recognise the presence of God in the Mass, in the world, or in their own lives. And this made me feel really sad. After all, it was going to be my job to try and help them to realise that God loves them through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, if you've come to church this morning expecting me to take apart the Holy Trinity and put it back together in a way that means you can all understand it, then I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed. What I want to do is to explore how God, through the Holy Trinity, Father, Son and Holy Spirit, can change our lives if we allow it, and at least we have some hope. The problem with the parish I was talking about a moment ago is that in the main, they didn't see themselves as being in relationship with God, so that changed how they saw their faith. Fundamentally, our faith is about our relationship with God. And like all relationships, we need to work at it, or it will stagnate and die. As Christians who believe in the triune God, we are called to be accountable to initiate, build, and maintain a relationship with God. And in this way, we are guiding in our lives of discipleship. Through developing our relationship with God, we are called to practice a faith that is personal, not private, that is meant not only for heaven, but for our life on earth, here and now. In our gospel this morning, we hear that Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. This might suggest that Nicodemus is among those whom Jesus did not entrust himself in the verses that preceded today's gospel. Nicodemus, however, does not ask who Jesus is. He already knows because of the signs that Jesus has given. In his conversation with Nicodemus, Jesus starts to undo Nicodemus' certainty of who Jesus is. Jesus tells him that no one can see anything clearly about God or God's kingdom without being born from above. In this conversation with Nicodemus, Jesus refers to all three persons of the Trinity. God is the one who loves, and who, because God is not willing to let us perish, gives us Jesus the Son. God sends the Son not to condemn the world, but to rescue and restore it, and the same for us. The Greek word sozo, which appears in verse 17, means save or saved. Save in the sense of to rescue, to heal, or to make whole. Jesus, the Son of God, the human one, the Son of Man, descending from and ascending to heaven, thus connecting heaven and earth, remaining in constant contact with the Father, and revealing God by bearing witness to all that is seen and known. Just like the serpent that Moses lifted up in the wilderness in the book of Numbers, Jesus, we know, is lifted up on high, is crucified, resurrected, and ascended in order to save us from our sins, that we might truly believe and truly be changed by our relationship with God. When we become sure of what we know about the Trinity, when we feel that we have nothing more to learn, this is when we will become undone, just like Nicodemus. The overturning of our certainty may well be a good thing if we are brave enough to allow it to change us. If it allows us to experience the miracle of our birth from above into eternal life. This gift of life from the Holy Trinity, beginning with the love of the Father, the breath of the Holy Spirit, which comes over us and through our very being, opening our eyes to God the Son, Jesus our Lord and our Redeemer, who is lifted up to draw all people to himself. The question question that we can ask ourselves this morning, if we are brave enough to, is, are we going to be like the people who turn to darkness, those who are too afraid to investigate a relationship with God, to allow their relationship with God to change them? Or are we going to be the people who are brave enough and faithful enough to allow the Holy Trinity to inspire us to develop our relationship with God, both as individuals and a community of faith, truly believing in the transformational power of the Holy Spirit? Or in traditional Johannine language, are we ready enough, are we ready and brave enough to come and see? To come and see what a loving, living relationship with God might be like. Remember and notice that in John's Gospel, faith is always a verb. And although it may take some of us longer than others to truly believe, to be confident in our faith, to truly believe that God loves us and that God wants a relationship with us, but for all of this journey of faith and for the effort that it takes, we know in our hearts this journey will always be worthwhile. Amen. Together we affirm our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Holy Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray for the church and for the world and thank God for God's goodness. Let us pray. In the Anglican cycle of prayer for our diocese, we pray for St. Peter Caleb and St. Mary Sutton cum Duckmanton. In the worldwide cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Mexico. We pray for the Church throughout the world, that it may be a beacon of hope, a beacon of light, and a harbinger of peace. We pray for our bishops, Libby and Malcolm, for the continued work of our diocese. We pray today for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, that it may comfort, restore, and guide all people. Almighty Father, whose will is to restore all things in your beloved Son, the King of all, govern the hearts and minds of those in authority, and bring the families of the nations, divided and torn apart by the ravages of sin, to be subject to his just and gentle rule. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for peace in our world. We pray for a fair division of healthcare and resources. We continue to pray for the people of India, so decimated by COVID-19. We pray for those who try to administer the vaccine, for those who send vaccines through the worldwide resource, and to those aid agencies helping to administer to those in hard-to-reach places. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our education system, for our local schools and colleges, for those for whom assessments have now finished, for our teachers, that they may gain some rest, for parents who find it hard to have their children at home, for those who cannot cope, and for those for whom this time brings extra financial burden. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. We pray for those who have asked for our prayers this morning, for John Robinson, Sheila Laverick, Joan Lydgate, Teddy, Jude Franklin, John Herring, Michael Catton, Patricia Mitchell, Sue Hastings, Jean Maiden, Jane Jackson, David Staves, Laura, Robin Glasson, Kenneth Hughes, James Stretton, Paul Taylor, Margaret, Ray Hearn, Tom Pierce, members of the Wolf Kid family, Valerie Alice Seeley, Daisy Wallace, Christopher Brown, Sandra Jones, Tony Reagan, Richard Harrison, Baby Thea, Liz Parker, Julie Weeks, and any that we name now in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who have died recently, praying particularly for Robert Marriott, and for those whose anniversary of death occurs this week: Harold Locke, Millicent Roberts, Walter Frederick Mather, Theo Singh Ailey, Joyce Mary Lowe, George William Wilson, Arthur Davidson, Joyce Grant, Kathleen Mary Wilson, Nellie Flaxman, George Henry Sedgwick. Gracious God, surround us and all who mourn this day with your continuing compassion. Do not let grief overwhelm your children or turn them against you. When grief seems never ending, take them one step at a time along your road of death and resurrection, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Time for our second COVID reminder, which is about communion. So when you come up for communion, please come up single line up the middle of the aisle. You stand here at the chancel step and I can gauge the distance between us. Please remove your mask before you leave your place, so there's no fumbling here at the chancel step, and put your mask back on after you've got back to your place. There is no rush when giving out and receiving communion, so please be respectful of other people. Keep the 2 metre distance at all times. And if you're heading down the side to come back up the middle and people haven't received, just be patient with them. I think that's everything for second COVID announcements. Peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father. Peace from his Son, Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Peace from the Holy Spirit, the life-giver. The peace of the triune God be always with you.
The Lord be
bread and wine may be towards the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom. So that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever. Saviour hath taught and commanded us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory, who are three persons yet one God, now and forever. Amen. We pray together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning to celebrate with us. A brief reminder that as you leave church, please can you keep the 2 metre distance, put your booklets and your sign-up sheet into the box, please, along with anything else you've touched, except the pew sheet, which you're welcome to take home, because it's got details of all the services in the coming week, including a sun mass on Thursday evening for the Feast of Corpus Christi, which is at 7:30 in the evening. That's the choral mass and procession. As you leave church, I will be at the back along with other people, happy to talk, but we'll keep away from the door. Then people that want to leave can leave, and those that want to chat in small groups can stay and chat. Hopefully the sun is still out and we can gather and enjoy the weather together and say goodbye to each other. It would be rude of me not to say thank you very much to Father Patrick and to Father James for allowing me the privilege and pleasure of singing the Mass this morning. It's a great honour, and all I can say to you both is thank you. It doesn't sound enough, but it's a heartfelt thank you. It's been an absolute joy and a privilege. And to those joining online, I hope you have a pleasant afternoon as well. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth in peace, in the name of Christ. Amen.